गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू. माय सेल्फ गणेश दांगट, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम करमोर भाऊराव पाटील कॉलेज ऑफ इंजिनियरिंग सातारा, कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजिनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट. इन दिस इंटरनेशनल फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम ऑन एनवायरमेंटल एंड सस्टेनेबिलिटी आई हैव चूज अ केस स्टडी नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी एंड नैनो पार्टिकल्स एंड इट्स ISO स्टैंडर्ड्स फॉर सस्टेनेबल एनवायरमेंट. इन द फर्स्ट वीडियो I have explained about the nanotechnology, and in the second video I have explained effect of nanoparticles on human health. So outcome of these two videos are describe the nanotechnology products and nanoparticles are used from the environments. Effect on nanotechnology products and nanoparticles on environment. Third one is effect of nanoparticles on human health. Now we'll see the standards for the nanotechnology. When it comes to standards, measurement standards are probably the most familiar. The international systems of units, abbreviated as SI from the system international utilities, is widely accepted in science and technology. The first metrology standards agreed on the meter and the kilogram were part of the 1875 Convention of the Meter, a diplomatic treaty between 54 nations. Today, SI and other globally accepted standards are vital to continue progress in nanotechnology research and development and safe, secure and responsible commercialization of nanotechnology in this year ahead. Who set these all standards? Around the world, there are numerous standards sitting groups that are involved in developing nanotechnology standards. Some of the leading standard sitting organizations and their relevant nanotechnology committees are. The first one is the International Standard Organization, ISO Technical Committee 229 on nanotechnologies. Second one is ASTM, International Committee E56, formerly known as the American Society for Testing and Material. The third one is International Electrotechnical Commission, Technical Committee 113, Nanotechnology Standardization for Electrical and Electronics Products and the Systems. And the last one is Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers Nanotechnology Council. So these are some organizations which will set the standards for the nanoparticles. There are three kinds of standard. The first one is a measurement standard, second one is reference standard, and third one is documentary standards. We'll see the first one, what is mean by a measurement standard. The measurement standard, the international systems of unit has seven base quantities: length, mass, time, electric current, thermodynamic temperature, amount of substances, and luminous intensity. The respective base units, the meter, kilogram, second, ampere, Kelvin, mole, and candela, are often combined to make derived unit such as the joule for the energy, work, and heat, hertz for the frequency, and volt for the electric potential. All are relevant to nanotechnology. In particular, the unit of length at the nanoscale, the nanometer, this is the standard prefix units that is derived from the base unit meter by subdividing the meter by the factor of 1 million. So these are the measurement units, that is the multiple, that names like deca, hecto, kilo, mega, giga, tera, peta, exa, zeta, and yuto, and the fractions like decimal, centimeter, millimeter, micro, nano, pico, femto, atto, zepto, and yotto. So these are some measurement units that we are using. Then second part, second type is reference standard. Standard reference material are used to verify a quantitative measurement. These are material that are certified by a national standard laboratory to have specific characteristics. Reference to the fundamental SI systems of physical units of measurements. The International Bureau of Weight and Measure, located in Servoz near Paris, France, has the task of ensuring worldwide uniformity of measurement and their traceability to the SI basic units. The next standard is a documentary standards, and we are interested in this documentary standards. Documentary standards define agreed upon the terminology or standard language for a field of science, engineering and technology. They are agreed upon means of conducting measurements, agreed upon performance characteristics of instrument or commercial products, and particularly they are documented agreement on means to facilitate trade and commerce. So these are some standards. The topics like terminology, measurement, EHS effect and the educations. So in the terminology we'll see there are two ISO standard, that is the ASTM E2 90913 and ISO TS 80004-1 2010. The measurement standards is also having a two unique identifier. EHS standards is having also two unique identifier, and the education, there is an ASTM. So these all are having different titles. Also there are some standards for the nanoparticle like ISO 9276, which is a representation of result of particle size analysis. Second standard is ISO 26824 in 2013, which is a particle characterization of particulate systems vocabulary. The next one is ISO 17867 in 2015, which is an particle size analysis, small angle X-ray scattering. Next one is 17294-1 in 2006, which is related to the water quality. Application of inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometers. So these are some standards of nanoparticles. Then we'll see about the nanomaterial and the environment. Nanomaterial can be categorized in one dimension, two dimension and the three dimension. The one dimensional nanomaterial such as a thin films and engineering surfaces have been used in electronic industry and in fuel cells respectively. Two-dimensional nanomaterials such as carbon nanotubes, nanowires, nanobiopolymers have range of potential application. Computerized sensors, electronic display device, catalyst, energy storage, drug deliveries, etc. The three-dimensional nanomaterials such as fluorescence, non-nanomaterial oxides, dendrimers, quantum dots also have variety of potential applications. Electronic circuits, drug delivery, water purification, soil remediations, composites, fuel cells and chemical reagents. These are a three dimensions of nanomaterials. Now, nanomaterial manufacturing process. Nanomaterial manufacturing process can be classified into two categories, which is based on starting point of the process. The first one is a top-down process. Top-down manufacturing process primarily used by the semiconductor industry for production of computer chips. It starts with a large-scale object or pattern and gradually reduces to a nanostructure by using precision engineering and lithography. The second one is a bottom-up. In bottom-up manufacturing process, nanostructures are built by assembling individual atoms or molecules. Bottom-up manufacturing process can be divided into chemical synthesis, self-assembly, and positional assembly. Nanoparticles, nanomaterials, categories, origin, properties, and its applications. I have shown here a different nanomaterials and their origin and their unique properties. So nanomaterials like nanotubes, that is the hollow sphere, ellipsoid or cylindrical tube, spherical fluorescence are known as buckyballs, cylindrical fullerenes are called as the nanotubes. So its origin is entirely composed of a carbon. Its properties are high conductivity, high tensile strength, high surface area, novel electronic property, high molecular absorption capacity. And its applications are polymer composite, structural composite, coating, electromagnetic shielding, flat panel display, batteries, hydrogen storage. Second nanomaterial is nanowires. A nanowire is a single crystal conductor or semiconductor. Its origin is a gold, cobalt, copper, silicon, oxide, sulfides, nitrides. Its unique property is conductors and the semiconductors. It will be used as an interconnector for the transport of electrons and non-electronic devices. Third nanoparticle is or nanomaterial is a quantum dot. A quantum dot is a closely packed semiconductor or crystal. The number of atoms in a quantum dot can range from 1000 to 10,000. The origin of quantum dots, which is available in gold, metal, oxide, titanium oxides. The unique property of quantum dot is exhibit novel electronics, optical, magnetic, and catalytic property due to the distinct quantum size effect, and its applications like insulator, semiconductors, and magnetic materials. Then we'll see the potential risk of exposure of nanomaterial production processes. So whenever we are using that nanoparticles, it will also affect on environment. So whenever we are using these nanoparticles, we are performing some processes like synthesis process. So in the synthesis process, that is nothing but it is a gas phase. So it will created a particle into the air. So it will generate the risk, that is the direct leakage from the reactor, product recovery, post recovery, processing, and the packing. And injection risk like airborne contamination of workplace, handling of product cleaning, and maintenance of the plant. The second one is the vapor phase. In that vapor phase, there is a particle formations in the form of substrate, and the risk like a product recovery, post recovery, processing, and the packaging. The third one is a colloidal process. In the colloidal process, that particles are in the format of liquid suspension. The potential risk is drying of products, processing, and the spillage. The spillage or containment of workplace, this is the high risk of this particular synthesis process. Then, effects of nanomaterial on Earth. Carbon dioxide is released into the atmosphere by the burning of fossil fuels. It is the present in the Earth atmosphere at the low concentration and act as a greenhouse gas. Nitrous oxide is eliminated from industrial activity as well as during the combustion of fossil fuel and solid waste. Methane is emitted when organic waste decomposes in landfills. Methane emission also occur during productions and transportation of fossil fuel. Volatile organic compounds are organic chemical compounds that have a high enough vapor pressure under normal conditions to significantly vaporize and enter the atmospheres. Then next nanomaterial is water vapor, is the most important greenhouse gas. The next one is ozone is formed due to the interaction between oxygen and ultraviolet radiations from the sunlight. Ozone exists in the broad band commonly called the ozone layer when emission from the automobiles and factories in the form of carbon and nitrogen react with sunlight, they produce ozone. Then this is a comparison chart of increase in temperature, carbon dioxide emission and world population from the year 1000 to the 2000s, and it is continuously increasing the all these three things, that is temperature, carbon dioxide emission and populations. In this graph I have shown what is the effect of vapor grown carbon on human health. So it will increases the radiations, there is change in climate, respiratory inorganics, then respiratory organics and the carcinogens. In the next slide it will shows a emission of carbon dioxide for the renewable intensive global scenario per capita per year and the millennium terms of carbon per years. There is another side of nanotechnology, nanoparticles also. There are some benefits of nanoparticles, like a sector of nanotechnology, nanoelectronics. The examples are electronic components and bioelectronic components. So the benefits are, it is energy efficiency, speed data processing and replacement of silicon. Another nano product is nano optics. The example of product is optoelectronic components, and it's having a higher data transfer rate and miniaturization. The third sector is nano fabrications, and the products are like nanostructure for electronic component, ultra thin layers of tool and components. And the advantage are, it is an energy efficiency, speed data processing and longer lifetime. The third sector is nanochemistry and the nanomaterials. Nanomaterials are like nanoparticles as a part from new material or the new composite, and the advantages like new mechanical, electrical, magnetically active, optical properties, and therefore unknown material functions, less weight and volume, improvement of the properties. So these are some benefits of nanomaterials also. So here I will conclude that nanotechnology has the potential of reducing greenhouse gases emissions significantly and thereby mitigating global warming. Our addiction to fossil fuels is most likely to major reasons of global warming. There has been a dramatic increase in greenhouse gases, particularly carbon dioxide, in recent times from the automobile and the industry. Nanotechnology address the global warming issues by minimizing or eliminating the fossil fuels, decreasing energy consumption and increasing the efficiency of existing technology. On the other hand, the technology consistently involves the use of nanomaterials, nanomembrane, nanocatalyst, aerosols, nanoparticles, etc. and their manufacture requires a significant amount of energy input. Currently, fossil fuels are the source of this energy input, which means that the entire purpose of reducing CO2 gas emission and preventing global warming is nullified. The only alternative available at our disposal is to use renewable source of energy. In addition, the economy of applying nanotechnology to solve the problem of global warming must be closely observed, and thus the need for a detailed cost-benefit analysis. Needless to say, firm commitments from major industries and the government alike to reduce greenhouse gases are also essential to our futures. I have used some paper and some Google sites also. The first one is the nano.gov. Second one is the list of useful ISO standard relating to the nanoparticles, definitions and characterization compiled by the James Well. The third one is environmental impact of nanotechnology by Mehboobuddin, a Trinity University, Raj Chowdhury, Kent State University. The fourth one is effect of nanotechnology on global warming by W.S. Khan, M. Klein and E. Astulu and R. Asmutulu, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Department of Industrial and Manufacturing Engineering, Wichita State University. Thank you.